In the previous chapter, we talked about the differences between Bell engines and Aerospike engines, and we also touched on the reentry of Aerospikes and how they can ease the loads on the vehicle. In this case, reentry is a requirement to allow for later recovery and reuse of the vehicle. In this chapter, we'd like to introduce you to the advantages of reusing launch vehicles and how our approach is one of the most sustainable in the world. Launch vehicles usually consist of two or more stages, an upper and a lower stage, stacked on top of each other, with the payload on the very top under the fairing. For a typical launch vehicle, the total cost of the first or lower stage as compared to the entire vehicle is about 60 to 70%, depending on whom you ask. In turn, the cost of the main engine as compared to the entire first stage is also in the size order of 60%. That equates to around 40% of the hardware cost of the entire launch vehicle. Indeed, the main engine is one of the most important parts to reuse. The economics of reusability is not straightforward. On one hand, it might seem clear that reusing launch vehicle hardware will lower your cost per launch, since you don't need to waste your entire vehicle on a single flight. However, launch vehicle reuse is frankly much more complex than that, and there are also some other important downsides to the concept that must be considered if you want your system to make economic sense. By reusing a launch vehicle, or any of its hardware, there will naturally be the need for added systems and hardware to enable this reuse. For example, re-entry and landing systems. This will not only add additional cost and complexity to the vehicle, but also mass. More mass of your vehicle will naturally mean less mass of payload that you can bring to orbit, meaning generally less revenue. Reusability also has an effect on the launch vehicle operation costs, as it requires the addition of more operations for the post-flight recovery and refurbishment. Here it should be noted that operations are a huge part, and in some cases the majority, of the overall cost of launch for any launch vehicle. So keeping those costs low and under control is fundamental. Even so, we see a clear trend in the sector towards reusability. And that's because there are several pros with reusability as well. Apart from the obvious benefit of hardware reuse, reusability has a positive effect on CapEx and production costs, as well as on the time between launches and launch flexibility. Capital expenditures and production costs can be lowered by enabling one vehicle to perform multiple missions, meaning less vehicles are needed overall to cover the same capacity. Another consequence of this is that ramping up and down in your launch cadence from one year to another is more practical than for an expendable vehicle, as the production line cannot accommodate such agility when the number of produced vehicles always needs to be equal to the number of flights. However, with a reusable vehicle, the hardware can be kept at the ready as needed, allowing you to adjust to the yearly launch needs of the market. Finally, a last important thing is that reusable vehicles have an easier time to cover bigger swaths of the market, as even in the case you cannot fully fill your vehicle's payload, the fact that you can reuse your hardware after flight reduces the associated punishment of flying with only a half load of satellites under your fairing. Overall, as compared to expendable options, we truly believe reusability within the launch vehicle sector is here to stay. It's important to note, however, that in order to fully utilize the advantages of reusability, you need to focus on a number of key factors. To make reusability make sense, you firstly need a high recovery rate, i.e. the technology used has to be able to successfully recover a high number of your vehicles. You also need a high reuse rate, meaning that you need to maximize the number of flights the hardware is able to perform. Another thing to note, and that was mentioned earlier, is that you have to be careful not to let the cost of operations overtake the gains made by reuse, so that the cost of operations must be kept low by utilizing efficient ground infrastructure and minimizing the need for operations, but also by taking this into account immediately at the vehicle design phase and designing the system from the ground up, taking into account user-friendliness, post-flight inspection, and refurbishment.
Another very important choice at engine level for reusability is the selection of propellants. We selected methyl ox or liquid oxygen liquid methane because this is the best combination for volumetric specific impulse in the market. Also, we selected this combination because methane doesn't leave residues basically in the combustion chamber. It doesn't leave soot during the combustion process, or minimum soot, and it doesn't coke inside the cooling channels, meaning that you don't have to refurbish the engine that much after flight. Also, another very important reason why we selected liquid methane is that it's a soft cryogenic, so it's not as hard to handle as hydrogen, but it's still a cryogenic. And in order to cool an aerospike like the one we're developing, you really need a lot of mass flow rate to be used inside the regenerative cooling circuit. And so you need the two propellants to be cryogenics, liquid oxygen and liquid methane, and you need to cool with both, what we call the regenerative cooling, the dual regenerative cooling circuit of the engine. Also, since methane doesn't leave too many residues inside the combustion chamber, this means that it's greener when burning with oxygen, but this will be clearer in the following.
At Pangea Space, sustainability is part of our DNA. We first decided to go for the aerospike engine because of its higher efficiency. And to make the aerospike engine a reality, we had to make several systemic choices that finally led us to having one of the most sustainable rocket engines in the world. Five main elements make Arcos highly sustainable and green. First, let's start with the choice of propellants. Liquid oxygen and liquid methane is the second best propellant mix in terms of performance and in terms of emissions, just after LOX hydrogen, as Federico has just explained. One for methane mostly to facilitate reusability of the engine, as it does not leave any coking in the channels. This is not the case with more polluting propellants, such as kerosene-based propellants. Kerosene, apart from emitting much more CO2 and leaving soot in the atmosphere, makes reusability very hard. Other organizations like SpaceX or Ariane Group are also going for methane engine for the same reason. Regarding production of methane, I think it is important to mention that we are working with local biomethane producers. Our biomethane comes from farms or residual waters, allowing us to have an almost carbon neutral solution. The second aspect that makes Arcos one of the greenest engines in the world is its higher efficiency. Using an aerospike engine instead of a bell nozzle engine allows us to be up to 15% more efficient. Therefore, we do only 6 launches using an aerospike, whereas we would do 7 launches with a bell nozzle to bring the same mass to orbit. This leads, of course, to major savings in energy consumption, linked to operations, logistics, manufacturing, refurbishment, and materials used. The third aspect is that the engine is designed to be reusable. Since we started on a blank piece of paper, it was clear to us that we needed to design for reusability. Designing an engine and then trying to make it reusable is doable, but it leads to many problems and higher cost, as many companies are facing, both in Europe and the US. As we were starting, we had the chance to rethink the whole engine system and to set the requirements for reusability. The objective is that the engine survives 50 or more cycles. And this requirement had consequences on the choice of materials, the propellant mix, the cooling system, the injection system, and most importantly, the easily removable parts of the engine for post-flight inspection, amongst others. The fact that the engine is reusable has an impact on manufacturing. As we reuse the engine at least 10 times, we drastically reuse manufacturing and metal usage, mostly of our copper alloy. We only produce one engine for it to be used 10 times. In an unexpendable configuration, it would mean that we would need to produce 10 engines with its associated energy consumption and material needs. Thanks to our RTB, we could validate through CFD and wind tunnel testing the fact that an aerospike tail first reentry creates a bow shock and that it acts somehow as an actively cooled heat shield. Daniele spoke about this in the episode 2, if you want to deep dive on it. So as a conclusion, as launches are expected to grow significantly in the upcoming years, the emissions coming from launching and manufacturing launchers will increase consequently. At Pangea Space, we try to stay ahead of the curve and to propose solutions to reach space without making a significant harm to Earth.